service today as we have an opportunity to gather around God's grace to us and also to share in God's grace that he poured out on Gary Anthony throughout his life here on this earth. Gary is now resting and rejoicing with Jesus in heaven, and our service today is all about God's grace to him and to remind us that that same grace that God gave to Gary is the grace he gives to us too. I invite you to follow along as we worship our Lord today. It's printed for you in your worship folders. I also posted it on our Facebook page, so the electronic version is available there for anybody who may be on Facebook Live at this time. And for those of you who are here, we'll also have it up on the screen today as well. We begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We've come together to seek God's comfort in our sorrow, and to rejoice in the promise of the resurrection. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you wept at the grave of your friend Lazarus, and you consoled Mary and Martha in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Gary Anthony, and dry the tears of all who weep. Calm our troubled hearts, dispel our doubts and fears, and lead us to praise you for having brought him to faith. In your rising from the dead, you conquered death and opened the gates to eternal life. Strengthen us with your word, and lead us through this earthly life, until at last we are united with you and all the saints, in glory everlasting. Amen. I invite you to listen now to those comforting, familiar words of that Good Shepherd Psalm, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I invite you to join in singing the three stanzas that are posted for "I Know That My Redeemer Lives." We'll sing stanzas 1, 7, and 8.
Thank you.
invite you to join in the responsive resurrection comfort. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. The Apostle Paul writes to the Romans, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Jesus gives us this comfort. "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Death has been swallowed up in victory. Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then we also will appear with him in glory. We will be before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. Never again will we hunger. Never again will we thirst. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be our shepherd. He will lead us to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Let us pray. God of all grace, you sent your Son Jesus to destroy the power of death and to open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we too shall live. Comfort us with your promise that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We continue with the two stanzas of Amazing Grace. Three scripture lessons that we have before us today are ones that Gary himself picked out for today. This first lesson are the words that I actually shared with Gary about an hour before he went home to heaven. Incredible words from the Old Testament book of Job. When we look at these words which we sang just a few moments ago, right? I know that my Redeemer lives. The Holy Spirit gave these words to Job, these incredibly joyful, peaceful words. Not after everything got better in his life, right? Because you know at the end of the book of Job, everything that he lost, he got back. These words come in the middle when Job is still suffering at the lowest point in his suffering. And that's what resurrection faith is, isn't it? Resurrection faith is clinging to the promises of eternity
even when life is at its toughest. Job chapter 19. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead or engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. This is the word of the Lord. Second lesson is from the New Testament letter to the Philippians. Recall the letter to the Philippians. The Holy Spirit gave these words to the Apostle Paul when he was in dire straits. Right? When he was in prison, not knowing if he was going to get out or whether he was going to be put to death. And what does he say? Don't be anxious. Take everything to the Lord with prayer and thanksgiving. Your parents taught you to say thank you, didn't they? But they taught you to say thank you when you received something. What God tells us here, we say thank you to God as we're asking him for those things in prayer, as we're coming to him in prayer, because of the confidence we have of knowing that God will hear us and he will answer us in the way that's exactly best for us and our eternal benefits. Philippians chapter 4. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel for today, this final message that Gary chose for us today, is from Matthew chapter 11. We actually had this gospel lesson about a month or two ago in our Sunday morning worship. But words to remember. There are burdens in our lives. We do get weary. But we have the best rest giver ever. The one who provides rest for our souls and makes our burdens light because he carries them for us. He carried them right to the cross, and he continues to carry them for us each and every day in our lives. Matthew chapter 11. Jesus is speaking. He says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." This is the word of the Lord. We continue with our next song on Eagle's Wings. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all glory and power and praise. Amen. I want to share with you the life of Gary, the obituary that's written in the back of your worship folder. You're invited to follow along as I read it. Gary Leonard Anthony, age 78, passed away August 26, 2020. He is survived by his daughter, Anne Marie O'Quinn, son, Scott Lloyd Anthony, sister, Kathy Dittmer, and six grandchildren, Christian Anthony, Gabrielle Anthony, Timothy O'Quinn, Robert O'Quinn, Elena O'Quinn, and Lee O'Quinn. A native of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and a resident of Madison County since 2008. Gary was also a member of Lamb of God Lutheran Church. Gary loved life. He loved using his gifts in many ways throughout the years. He worked for a security company in Minnesota. He used his gifts to serve God's church in many ways throughout the years, including, but certainly not limited to, the Board of Education and the Board of Elders. He could always be seen serving his Lord with a cup of coffee in his hand, hence his urn, which is actually a can of coffee. As Gary's health failed him in his later years, he continued to serve his Savior by encouraging others in their faith and also by being an example of patience under suffering. Gary lived each day knowing and clinging to the cross of Jesus, his Savior, for the forgiveness of his sins and his assurance of eternal life. Visitation today at 10, service at 11 at Lamb of God. The portion of God's word that Gary and I talked about for sermon, he gave me a choice of a couple, and this is the one I picked. Because it says, I think, more clearly than just about any passage in the Bible, why it is that Gary is partying with Jesus in heaven right now. Ephesians chapter 2, we're just looking at verses 8 to 10, but if you have the opportunity today, read all 10 verses, starting at chapter 2, verse 1. And it gives you just a beautiful picture of God's grace to Gary, but also God's grace to you. Verses 8 to 10. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. This is the word of our God. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight and comfort our hearts, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In the name of our loving Savior, Jesus Christ, your fellow redeemed, and especially you, the family of Gary. Last Wednesday evening, about 9 o'clock, God answered the main prayer that Gary had been praying for a while. It was a prayer to go home to be with Jesus. He went home. In fact, I was somewhat confused the week before when I was getting messages. Sheila and I were actually on vacation, and I got a message that Gary had gone home because he had gone to the hospital. And my initial thought was, Gary went home to heaven, but not yet. Gary went back to his home and received some incredible care from two main caregivers who are actually with us today, and I would encourage you to have an opportunity to talk with them if you're able to stay for a little bit after the service. We're going to have some fellowship as well. But just wonderful care that Gary received over the months, and especially in that last week. Family was there. Wonderful caregivers. giving him all the things that he needed. But that really wasn't what Gary wanted, right? Gary wanted to go home to be with Jesus. Gary loved his family. He loved his church family. He loved his coffee. But most importantly, Gary loved his Savior because Jesus loved him first. These words of God for our comfort today, to comfort our hearts and to give us this peace and the strength that we need to continue living our lives of faith. These are words that Gary clung to his entire life. He craved them. He couldn't get enough of them. He was so thrilled when we started doing the whole service on Facebook Live last spring because he wasn't able to come worship with us. And he said, all I can catch are a couple of services on TV, and I don't want to watch those services. I want my church family. So that was great. In fact, it actually got him back on Facebook. He had been off for a number of years, right? He actually recreated his Facebook page, got back on Facebook just so he could participate in worship again. And he was the first one who signed on to every service, the first one to type, good morning, Lamb of God family. Love you. He couldn't get enough of those words because he knew that God loved him. He knew that God saved him. How? Why? He would have been the first one to tell you, I'm no good. I've done horrible things. I've said horrible things. I've thought horrible things. Gary knew that. As I've had a chance to visit him on a regular basis, we often talked about those sins. But you know what? We talked about them in the past because that's exactly what they were, right? They were in the past because Jesus' blood had already covered them. They're gone. The guilt remains no more. It never ceased to amaze him how much God loved him and how God could save a person like him. He would have been singing the loudest on that first verse of Amazing Grace, who saved a wretch like me. That's God's grace, though, isn't it? God's grace is his love for us. And God doesn't love us because of who we are. He loves us because of who he is. His qualities. Perfect love. Perfect mercy. And a perfect salvation that he worked out from start to finish for us. It's his undeserved love for sinners. And as I mentioned, Gary would have been the first one in line to admit that he was a sinner, totally unable to please God on his own. Unable to believe in God. And yet, oh, so thankful. So thankful that God gave him this gift of grace and this peace that he had in his life, knowing that he had a Savior who loved him, forgave him, and had heaven waiting for him. It was a done deal. You see, a true gift is something that you give out of pure love, right? No strings attached, nothing on your part. Right? You don't go up to somebody and say, I'll give you this gift if you promise to be nice to me. I'll give you this gift if you do some good things for me, and if once you've done enough good things for me, then I'll give you this gift. A gift is a gift, isn't it? Your parents probably threatened when you were a kid, right? If you keep this up, I'm taking all your Christmas presents back, or taking all your birthday presents away. But it never happened, right? Because they're gifts. And this is what God describes, isn't he? Our salvation. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. It's a gift. It's the gift of God. The thing that makes the gift so special then is the person who's giving it, not the person who's receiving it. Now, the person who's receiving it, right, they understand how special they are to that person. But friends, we can't say, God saved me, and then at the same time say, well, I had something to do with it too. If God saved me, God saved me. I didn't save me. God did. And that's what God tells us here. God gave Gary a brand new life. He secured that life for him at his baptism. And that's why the baptismal font is front and center there. Right? Right in front of what are his human remains. Right? He's partying up with Jesus in heaven. This is what Jesus is going to raise on the last day. But in front of that is the baptismal font that reminds us God placed his name on Gary Anthony. He washed him clean of his sins. He adopted him into his family and made him his child. That's the comfort that we receive. The Holy Spirit gave this special gift to him. All because Jesus died for Gary's sins. All because Jesus rose again from the dead. He paid Gary's way to heaven. And Gary knew that was the only way he was going to get there. It's the only way I'm going to get there. It's the only way you're going to get there too. That's why the Lord tells us, it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Right? Not from yourselves, not by works, no boasting. God's pretty clear here, isn't he? In his love, God did not leave the door open, even a crack for us to contribute to our salvation, because I would have blown it. That's what he tells us at the beginning of the chapter, by the way. As for you, you are dead in your transgressions and sins. And he's speaking to the Gentile believers there. But then he addresses the people of the promise, right? The Israelite believers too. He says, you're no different. We're no different from them. We also lived in that same squalor of being spiritually dead. But God made us alive, even when we were dead in our sins. It's by grace you've been saved. There's a reason why God left us out, right? And that's what I just shared with you, those words from the beginning of the chapter. That means that all credit from beginning to end, as far as our salvation is concerned, it all goes to God. Because if God saved me, and he did, then he's the one who receives all the credit. He's the one who receives all the glory. Jesus has now given Gary the ultimate fulfillment of this brand new life created in him at his baptism. He knows he's in heaven. He's having a cup of coffee with Jesus right now. And as I mentioned to him the other day too, he loved to sing. But I sat next to Gary in choir for about 7 years at the previous congregation I served. I've known Gary for over 21 years. He would be the first one to, he had a hard time hitting a right note. I said, Gary, when you get to heaven, you're going to sing, and you're going to sing perfectly. And he just smiled. Right? Remember him smiling when I said that? Right? We didn't get a lot of reactions out of him, but that brought a smile to his face because he knew he was about to sing with Jesus forever. That party was going to begin, and he couldn't wait. Eternal life in heaven is his. Yeah, he's rejoicing with his Savior. Not because he loved Jesus, and not because he served God in his life in so many ways. He's not up in heaven with Jesus because he went to church. And he's not up in heaven with Jesus because he was a good father and grandfather and good friend and mentor. None of those things got him to heaven. None. Gary's in heaven because Jesus died for his sins. Gary's in heaven partying with Jesus right now because the blood of Jesus, his son, God's son, purified him from every one of his sins. Gary's life as a believer was a life of thanking God. He sought to do that in every way, shape, and form he possibly could. God did something special for him. And God talks about it in that final verse of our lesson today. We're God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. You notice how God's grace works? God's grace brings us into his family of believers, and that same grace is what empowers and enables us each and every day to live the life that God wants for us and to do all these things for people displaying the love of Jesus. God's grace is working in all of those things. He enables us to do those things that please him. He gives us opportunities for service. God says we're his handiwork. Literally what he's talking about, we're God's works of art. If you think of a sculpture or a painting, or if you're a poet writing poems, right? When you look at sculptures and you look at paintings, you go to an art gallery, you marvel at the painting, but what are you really marveling at? You're marveling at the artist who created that work of art. God says we're his works of art. But he's the artist. He's the one who puts everything into place in our lives to be able to serve him. And Gary gave honor to God. He thanked him during his life. And what God had given to Gary, Gary wanted for all the people around him. Right? That's why he talked about Jesus all the time. I'm looking at a whole bunch of people that he talked to and encouraged pretty much every time he saw you. Whether it was a reminder of how important church was, whether it was a reminder to stay close to Jesus and that faith that he had given, whether it was encouragement to use your gifts to go outside the box and do something you've been thinking about for a while. He used those gifts. But that was God's grace to Gary as well. And God used his grace to Gary to grace us. And that's what Christian living is all about, isn't it? Christian living is all about taking this grace that God has showered into our lives and then reflecting and pouring it out in our day-to-day activities, conversations, and attitude. As I mentioned, reading through his obituary, right? That was one of the ways that Gary did serve. Oh yeah, he did complain once in a while, right? He grimaced when he was moving around, right? He was in a lot of pain, and you know, there were times when he lost it. But what tremendous patience! What grace under suffering! He didn't do that on his own. He didn't muster up the strength to be able to go through another day. That was the Holy Spirit guiding him. That was God giving him that strength every day. And when God was ready, when he knew that time was right, he said, okay, enough. I'm releasing you from that. And I'm going to give you what I had planned for you from eternity. Your eternal existence with me. Right? God wants a lot of things for us. But the one thing he wants more than anything else is for us to be with him in eternity. He's given that to Gary. But you know, he's always also done that same thing for each and every one of you. What God did for Gary Anthony, he has done for all of us. And that's the message, right? That's the message that God wants for us today. That's the message that Gary wants for us today. He was pretty clear with me. We talked about this several times. We sat down over a year ago and went through all these things. But he made it pretty clear. Talk about my sin and talk about God's love for me. Talk about God's love for you too. Because that's what finally matters. That's why he talked about Jesus all the time. That's why he was willing to serve right up until the very end. We sat down a couple months ago and he said, I probably should step down from elders. He didn't. And even 2 weeks ago when we were on vacation, remember, he was the normal contact, right? I said, Gary, are you sure? He said, yeah, I want to be the contact. I want people to call me if there's any need while you're gone. Right up until the very end. He wanted to serve his Savior. He wanted to say thank you to the God who had given him everything for this life and for eternity. He knew how important God's word was for you because he knew how important it was for him. Right? What Jesus did for Gary, he's done for you. It's so simple, but it's so precious. See, in spite of who we are, in spite of what we are, God says, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That gift of God's grace is his gift for us. And so take comfort, not only in what God did for Gary, but the fact that he did the same thing for you. God's grace makes all the difference, right? It made all the difference for Gary. It makes all the difference for us too. So rejoice. Rejoice in this amazing gift of God's grace to Gary Anthony. But rejoice also in God's amazing grace to you. Take comfort in his promises. Cling to that strength, the only strength that he can provide. The God who promised these things, he's faithful to his promises. He was faithful to Gary Anthony and has him in heaven now. He's faithful to you as well. God give you that peace, that comfort, and that strength. Amen. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's join now in confessing our Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the two stanzas of Speak, O Lord. Thank you.
invite you to join the responsive prayer of the church. Almighty God, we praise you for the great company of saints who have finished their lives in faith and now rest from their labors. We remember especially our loved one, Gary Anthony, whom you redeemed by the blood of your Son and received as your dear child through holy baptism. We thank you for giving him to us as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your compassion, comfort all who are sad in this hour. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We praise you for your love in Christ, which sustains us in life and death. In our earthly sorrows, help us find strength in the fellowship of the church, joy in the forgiveness of sins, and hope in the resurrection to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You do not leave us comfortless, but strengthen and care for us through your word and sacrament. You give us family, friends, and neighbors to help when there is loneliness now and in the days to come. Brighten our future with a firm trust in your promises and care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Remove our doubts and make us bold to pray with confidence as our Savior has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We close with our final song, May the Peace of God.